Hi, welcome back to my channel. I am Dr. Neha and today I am going to discuss very important topic, which is microscopic technique, SEM and TEM. So let us discuss about what are they. Before that, you should have a clear background of what are basically electron microscopes. So electron microscopes are nothing but those microscopes which work as the same principle as that of light microscope. The only thing is they used to study the object on a very tiny scale and they use highly powered electron for that estimation. So what we can find out about the compound is their complete topography, morphology, composition, crystallographic information, and using only powerful electrons beam. That's it. So every electron microscope would use that focused beam of electron, which is accelerated towards the sample, and then you have to find out how the sample is interacting with the electron beam. Based on that, you will get some images and which we have to refer and understand what are the reasoning behind it. So it's similar that we capture images, we use optical microscope to capture images. It is similar to that, but yes, here the resolution of the image is very nice, very very high, and that's why it can reveal the internal composition also. There are basically two types of electron microscope if you go ahead by transmission and scanning electron microscope. There are others too, no doubt, but these two are the major important and are having wide applications. So today I'll cover only these two. Now when you focus the beam of electron to the any particular atom, so what happens on the surface of the atom, that scanning electron microscope will tell you. So at the atom, when the electron interacts with it, what happens at the surface, how is the surface morphology of atom, that you will be able to understand using SEM. But what is the internal structure of that atom? Because the electron is going to penetrate through the atom, right? And when it penetrates, then what is going inside the atom, that you will be able to find using transmission electron microscope. So I think it's clear, it's related to the internal structure, and this is basically the outer surface of the material. Coming to scanning electron microscope, as the name suggests, you need to scan the particular surface of the metal using electron beam. So here the focus beam of electron is used, and that is used to find the information. You will get a 3D image here, and that too black and white, and now you can magnify it up to 2 million times. Now you imagine if you can magnify your image to that much resolution, how much detail you can find out, and obviously the resolution is very high. So with that, you are able to identify the elements present in the substance. And if you go by the history, it all started with Manfred Born in 1937, who actually invented a microscope with high resolution and was able to scan a very very small raster. Further, the work was reported by other groups, and at the end in 1965, the Cambridge Scientific Instrument Company, they gave it to DuPont. So if you can see the first SEM, then if you see the difference, analog type SEM, and nowadays we use such kind of apparatus. Coming to the sample preparation here, the sample is coated with a thin layer of conducting material. So the material has to be conductive. If it is not, then you have to coat it with a conductive material. So normally gold is used for that purpose. Aluminium also can be used. Here you can see a spider, which is a sputter coated in gold, which is ready to be taken for the SEM estimation. So gold foil normally is used. Coming to the process, how the electron microscope looks like. So here the electron gun is there, which actually produces the electron beam. Tungsten wire is heated by the current. Now this beam is accelerated by the anode. The beam travels through this electromagnetic field and lenses, and they actually focus the beam towards the sample. Followed by these is scanning the coils. The mechanism of deflection coil enables to guide the beam so that it actually scans the surface of the sample in the rectangular frame. Now when this beam touches the surface of the particular sample, what happens, it produces some electrons. Like immediately secondary electrons can be produced, right? So when it falls on the sample, some electron may get released, and those you term it as a secondary electron. The electron can come back scattered, like immediately they are coming back, so they are back scattered, or they may come in the form of X-ray. So now what you have to do is the emitted SE is collected by this SED, the secondary electron detector, and they convert it into signal which is sent to the screen to produce the final image. So this is basically sent to the screen and produces the final image. And additionally, you can have detectors for these X-rays and for this backscattered electron. So backscattered electron detector you can place in extra and at the same time X-ray detector. So this is how an electron microscope do the work. Now coming to how do you get the images, now you see those beautiful images you get. Imagine a human bird look like this, and it is having different shape in the layman language, but when it comes to our domain, we see that these shapes actually show that there are different elements and materials present in it. Like the blood include white blood cell, lymphocytes, monocyte, neutrophil, small disc shape, platelets, etc. Similarly, the kidney stone looks like this. And now this is the same image of pollen. As I said, it's 3D, but it's black and white. Nowadays, there are possibilities to, automatically color it. So coloring is also available, and that gives beauty to the image, and easily you can find out there are three different types of elements involved here, right? So with the help of color you can magnify and find out the difference. Coming to the transmission electron microscope, the name itself suggests that here the energetic electrons are going to transmit through the sample, and they are how you are going to get the internal structure. Coming to it is giving you only 2D, not 3D, but yes, the resolution are still proper. Coming to the history, it all started in 1931 when the first electron microscope was developed. Later on, the Reinhold Rudenberg, scientific director, patented the electrostatic lens electron microscope in 1931. So it works on the same principle of optical microscope. And if you can see, this is the first practical TEM, which was like installed at Germany in 1976. You can see the image, and now this is the image of nowadays what TEM looks like. Coming to the working of TEM, this is very like in similar to that of SEM. Here also the specimen is like bombarded by a beam of electrons. The bombarded electrons are focused to the object, and basically the electrons pass through multiple electromagnetic lenses, and the beam passes through this solenoids, which are like tube wrapped in the coil, and they contact with the screen. Now here if you see the difference, the sample here is in between the column, while in SEM the sample was at the end of the bottom of the column. So this is the difference, because here the electrons are able to pass through it. The fine patterns of electrons leaving this object will reach the objective lens and it will form the image. This is when enlarged with the help of projector lens, and eventually those transmitting electrons reach the scintillator plate or a fluorescent plate which contains the phosphor compounds which can absorb the energy of striking electrons, and a contrasted image is formed on this plate. So in transmission electron microscopy, it is a little different that you have to allow it to pass through the sample, let electron go down, and then you find out how many electrons are transmitted and in what fashion. So coming to how does it look like, so see the SEM versus TEM image. SEM will give you only how pollen grain looks like from outside, which is outer surface, but internally they have so many components involved that you will be able to understand using TEM. Let us have one more example. This is related to COVID-19. The COVID-19 virus looks like this from outside, but if you go inside this, it looks like this. Coming to TEM images and SEM images of many, like blood cell, pollen grains, mitochondria, you can see internal structure and you can see outer structure from SEM. So I think now it is almost clear to you that what is the difference in the images. SEM images work with the outer structure, that this is of silicon, and internal structure TEM gives you the idea. So let us quickly go to the difference. I guess no need to explain it further, you'll be able to do. Let us go to the main thing, which is SEM versus TEM. What is the difference? So here you get a fine focused beam, here you can use a broad beam. The type of electrons are scanning, here the transmitted electron are there. The voltage range is usually up to 30 kilowatt, while here is quite higher. This will work on the surface, this to internal structure. The resolution comparatively here is lower, while here it is higher. The magnification is up to 2 million times, while it is 50 million times. maximum field of view is large, but here we see a very limited part of the sample because we want to go inside in the internal structure of the sample, and that is why the depth of field of system is higher here, where it is lower. The image creation here, it is done by detecting the reflected electrons or the knocked off electrons, right? While here, transmitted electrons are used to find out the image. Image formation here is done on like counted by detector, and the image you can see on PC screen. While if you remember in TEM, it was a fluorescent screen on which the direct imaging was done. Coming to one more, like image dimensions. So here obviously it's 3D, here it is 2D. Sample thickness, here you have to take very thin sample, but around thick sample can also do. While in transmission, it has to be ultra thin, less than 150 nanometer, because I guess you understand that the electron has to pass through it, so it has to be very ultra thin sample. Then the sample location at the bottom of the column, while here at the middle of the column. Here it does not penetrate the sample, the electron does not penetrate, it generates image of outer surface, while here it do penetrate. There is no sample restriction here, there are more, because you are very focused about the internal structure. Very less time is required for preparation here, while here more time is required. Cost effective, I think both are expensive, but this is lesser expensive in comparison to this. Obviously the speed is faster here and this is quite slower. And with respect to operation, it is easy to use in comparison to TEM, while it is more complicated. Coming to the applications, I think with this अभी तक आपको सारे disadvantage advantages पता चल गए होंगे, दोनों के बारे में एक थोड़ा idea आपको लग गया होगा और आपको ये समझ में आ रहा होगा. तो जस्ट टू कंक्लूड माई वीडियो, आई वुड नाउ इंक्लूड सम ऑफ द एप्लीकेशंस. सो वेर एवर यू गो इन द साइंस इंडस्ट्री, फार्मेसी, ड्रग्स, यू नो, यू विल फाइंड द एप्लीकेशन. लाइक इन मटीरियल साइंस, वी वर्क ऑन मटीरियल. एनी मटीरियल ऑन विच यू आर वर्किंग, लाइक सेंसर्स, सुपर कंडक्टर्स, ट्यूब्स, फाइबर्स, यू हैव टू फाइंड आउट द स्ट्रक्चर, एंड फॉर दैट इट इज extremely applicable. In fact, for the performance of semiconductors in the manufacture of chips and computers and all, for microchip assembly, in fact, because that is very complex, so 7-10 can be easily used to get the high resolution image. In forensics, where we get we have to analyze the gunshot residue, we need to examine jewelry, bullet marking comparison, handwriting, fingerprint analysis, there we have to use. Then in biological sciences, everywhere bacteria, viruses and all. Then in geology, where you have to find out the quality of soil. Then in medical sciences, to study all those tissues, blood cell and viruses. And obviously technology, because that technology companies also can use it to identify the flaws and the damage in the already existing product, so that they can make it more durable and efficient. And of course, universities can utilize it for research and studies. So with that, I would like to thank you all for being the patient listener. So if you have liked the content, please hit like, that will give me motivation. And if you're new to my channel, please do subscribe. Thank you so much.